Apple is, in my personal opinion, the absolute master of marketing. With each product they announce, they literally make you feel that those products will improve your life. Well, after my iPad Air 2 served me well for the past 6 years, it eventually stopped working correctly, because each and every update seemed to slow it down until it was unbearable to use it at all. Since I own a Neumann KH750 DSP monitoring system that can only be controlled through the exclusive iPad app, Neumann basically dictated that I need to purchase an iPad Pro 2020. Advertising made me believe that this new iPad Pro will help me become a better content creator, video editor, and overall a better human being. So, 6 months after purchasing it, I think it's time to come up with a conclusion whether the iPad Pro 2020 is your next computer as advertised or not. Furthermore, I decided to show you also how it actually holds up against the brand new high performance 2020 desktop PC under real life video editing conditions. And also, I want to compare it to my MacBook Pro 13-inch from work. So let's get started. Typical of a brand new Apple product, the iPad Pro 2020 sold out in minutes on its launch date. Since I was debating whether I should get one or not, I was kinda late in the game, but eventually couldn't resist anymore. Because 1. I wanted to be able to control my Neumann KH750 DSP system again, and at the same time I couldn't resist the advertising, which made me believe that the iPad Pro 2020 and LumaFusion could replace any video editing system because of its ability to handle 4K videos with ease. At that time, I still owned a 5.5-year-old PC that was equipped with a 5960X and GTX 1080, which weren't really meant for 4K video editing, and I thought buying an iPad Pro 2020 will save me some money, because it is actually cheaper than purchasing a brand new PC. Little did I know that my computer will die 2 months after, but that's a different story. And if you are interested in a review of its replacement, please let me know in the comments below and make sure you hit the subscribe button. The week waiting for the arrival of the new iPad Pro got me even more excited, because I was already imagining what I will create with all those brand new apps and accessories, such as the second generation of the Apple Pencil. Since I ordered everything directly from the online Apple Store, the package came in time. The packaging alone is an eye candy on its own, and I recommend that you keep the boxes just in case you want to sell it on auctioning platforms such as eBay in the future. Because, and that is probably nothing new to you, people pay more if Apple products are sold in their original packaging or even auction the packaging alone. My first impression of the iPad Pro 2020 was that I really liked the additional screen real estate of the 11-inch model compared to the 9.7-inch screen of the iPad Air 2. The reason why I decided to get the 11-inch model was its compact size and that I want to be able to travel with the iPad Pro. Furthermore, I was also attracted to the cheaper price point. 6 months later. Well, I haven't been able to travel with my iPad Pro 2020, but I've been definitely putting it to the test because I edited one music video solely on the iPad Pro using LumaFusion. If you are interested in how it turned out, click on the link on the top right corner. And if you want to know more about how to edit and color create a music video on the iPad Pro 2020, please also leave me a comment below and hit the subscribe button. But back to the iPad Pro 2020. What I still really like and not regret getting is the 11-inch model, because it is really handy to carry around, no matter if you are using it on the couch, on the balcony, while laying down on the bed, or even holding it in just one hand while running FaceTime with friends and family. It only weighs 641 grams or 22.61 ounces. But I definitely would recommend putting it into a case for protection, and that makes the overall weight, of course, more heavy. Speaking of cases, I purchased a cheap case for it on Amazon I'm really satisfied with and linked it in the info box below. Because I just think that the prices of the original Apple cases are insane for what you get. Also, I have to mention that I resisted buying the iPad Pro Magic Keyboard, because I think it's totally overpriced, and if I wanted a laptop like form factor, keyboard, weight and size, I might as well have bought a MacBook Pro 13-inch model with a similar price point. The only accessory I got is the second generation Apple Pencil, and I have to admit that I don't use it as often as I thought I would. I use it mainly for drawing, signing documents, or on creativity apps, since it's more precise than using your fingers on the touchscreen. One drawback of the Pencil is that not every app supports it completely. In LumaFusion, for example, you need to use your fingers for certain gestures because there's no Apple Pencil workaround. Let's talk about the screen. Everybody seems to rave about its 120Hz liquid retina display. And yes, it is good, reproduces colors very accurately and has a high peak brightness of 600 nits. But I noticed that if you tilt it slightly, it appears to darken immediately, and the only perfect viewing angle seems to be exactly 90 degrees from the front. This seems to be the downside of the ultra-low reflectivity, how Apple calls it. Overall, I prefer my LG 38WN95C monitor, which I also reviewed on this channel. Click on the top right corner to check out that review. What I really like about the iPad Pro 2020 is the USB-C connection and the fast charger that comes with it. It takes around 2 hours to fully charge the iPad Pro, and thanks to the USB-C connection, you can easily plug in a hard drive and access or save additional data on it. Unfortunately, the connection does not work with the USB-C Thunderbolt connection on my LG ultrawide screen monitor. So while I can charge the iPad using the cable, I can only connect it through the HDMI connection to my monitor, if I want to use it with a bigger display. And this brings me to the next issue. The iPad Pro is still not able to scale the image respective to the connected monitor. So no matter which device you connect it with, you will always end up with an unusual aspect ratio of 1.43 to 1. If you need to connect more than just one device using the USB-C port, you need expensive dongles for more connections. This can become very annoying because there are different dongles for different uses, and if you pick the wrong one, you might end up not being able to use your iPad Pro for what you intended it to. So always bring your suitcase full of Apple dongles should you be on the road. The base model of the iPad Pro 2020 comes equipped with 128GB of storage, and if you use an external hard drive to store additional files, it should suffice. If you prefer to save everything on the iPad itself and also work with large files such as video files, then I would recommend upgrading to either 256GB, 512GB or even the 1TB version. You can also choose between a Wi-Fi and cellular version. I purchased a cheaper Wi-Fi model, because if I want to access the internet with the iPad on the go, then I can also use my iPhone hotspot instead. It comes in two colors, silver and space gray. Since I always leave mine in the case, I don't really care about the color, but picked space gray simply because I like it better than the silver version. So, let's talk about the overall performance and surprising test results comparing the iPad Pro to my MacBook Pro 13-inch and my brand new Intel computer. First of all, I have to admit that I was kinda disappointed when Apple announced that the iPad Pro 2020 carries only an A12C chip rather than a brand new A14X everybody was talking about prior to the press release. That being said, every single application runs super smooth on the iPad Pro 2020, and so far I have not come across a situation where I wished for more power. For example, editing the music video in LumaFusion really put it to the test, and I'm surprised how well the iPad Pro handles multiple 4K video tracks on a project, even after putting on some transitions and effects in LumaFusion. LumaFusion allows up to 5 video and audio tracks, and still scrolling and scrubbing through the footage is stutter-free. This is really impressive, especially if I compare it to my MacBook Pro 13-inch model from 2019 with 16GB of RAM, 2.4GHz quad-core Intel Core i5 processor, and Intel Iris Plus graphics, 655, 1536 megabyte graphics card. On the MacBook Pro, I'm not able to edit 4K video footage at all. Premiere Pro CC is constantly stuttering and freezing after putting just one 4K video track on the timeline. I even tried to work with proxies, but the overall workflow is just painful. So I ended up limiting myself on HD videos when working on my MacBook Pro 13-inch model. So this first round of the showdown goes clearly to the iPad Pro 2020. But how does it hold up against a brand new desktop PC equipped with an i9-10940X and a NVIDIA RTX 2070 Super graphics card? For the test, I used the same music video file on both systems in native 4K resolution and 1.16GB in size. And the results really blew my mind. While I was able to load 5 4K video tracks on the iPad Pro 2020 using LumaFusion, I could only use 4 4K video tracks on my PC using DaVinci Resolve Studio. Both programs and machines handled the footage seamlessly without any hiccups, stutters or freezing. Exporting the 4K file on the iPad Pro took 1 minute and 40 seconds, while the PC only took 1 minute and 5 seconds, that is more than 50% faster. Still, both machines are totally capable of editing 4K footage and outperform the MacBook Pro 13-inch model from 2019 big time. This brings me to my conclusion. The iPad Pro 2020 is very powerful, but to date, the available apps are unfortunately the only limiting factor. I mean, LumaFusion is a great video editing program for mobile devices, but it's missing important features of other editing programs such as Final Cut Pro X, DaVinci Resolve Studio, and Adobe Premiere CC. I do wish that Apple-owned software products such as Final Cut Pro X and Logic Pro X would run on the iPad Pro 2020, especially since it's marked as your next computer. In my situation, the iPad Pro 2020 cannot replace my desktop PC, because the music applications and video software I like to use are simply not available for iPad OS. Still, I like my iPad Pro for what it is and for what I can use it for, like controlling my Neumann KH750 DSP system, browsing the web, using it for FaceTime, or using apps to create content. But it is definitely not my next computer. While it is great that with the latest iPad OS update, the device finally adds mouse, keyboard, and trackpad support, I find those accessories outrageously overpriced. So, I hope this review and performance comparison was helpful and would really appreciate it if you give it a thumbs up and subscribe to this channel if you are interested in more tech and music related videos. See you next time and have a great one.